Good morning, students. In previous class, I have started a radioactivity concept. So earlier we have completed a first part of the nuclear chapter, like what is the composition of the nucleus, what are the properties of the nucleus or characteristics of the nucleus, and what is the Einstein mass energy equation, what is the mass defective binding energy and average binding energy, binding energy curve and its features, and also about nuclear forces and the properties of the nuclear forces, what is the nuclear fission and chain reaction, what is a nuclear reactor, and also nuclear fusion, what is a source of energy for sun and stars. We have discussed carbon hydrogen cycle, proton cycle, etc. And then in the previous class, I have started a radioactivity. So definition I have given and some basic points also given. What type of radiations released by a radioactive sample or radioactive material also given, like alpha rays, beta rays and gamma rays. Up to that I have stopped in the previous class. Now in this class, we'll discuss what are the properties of alpha, beta and gamma rays. After completion of this one, we'll go for further remaining concepts. So generally any radioactive sample may take it is unstable radioactive radiations. We'll discuss in this class. So if you select any radioactive sample with atomic number more than 82, so the type of elements like uranium, plutonium, thorium, radium, radon, neptunium, protoactinium, so this type of all the elements you may select, so generally they are unstable. So from the binding energy graph also we came to know elements with a heavier mass number are unstable. They are having average binding energy less than 8 mega electron volt. So generally they also try to get the stability. So how they will get the stability? So maybe by releasing some particles, or maybe by absorbing some particles, they try to acquire the stability. In that process, the radioactive nuclei, uranium, plutonium, such type of nuclei, also begins to emit radiations in the form of alpha, beta and gamma. So that is a spontaneous process. While the process is going on, after some years, maybe 100 years or 1000 years, that depending upon the nature of the element and its half-life only, so finally the element gets a stability. So finally we will get generally what type of element means lead with atomic number 82 and mass number 208 onwards you can select radioisotopes are there. So lead is one of the stable element. So for getting a stability, all the unstable nuclei releases some radiations. So those radiations we are calling as radioactive radiations. But how many types of radiations are there means we have three type of radiations. One is alpha rays, and the second one beta rays, third one gamma rays. Alpha, beta and gamma rays, these are the three rays, alpha rays, beta rays and also gamma rays. So three type of radiations released by radioactive sample generally. Here what is alpha ray means? First we'll discuss about alpha and then we'll go for beta and gamma. What are alpha rays, or what is the nature or identity of this alpha? Means it is nothing but helium nucleus. Helium nucleus you should write. It is a helium nucleus. Helium means with atomic number 2, mass number 4. So generally helium atom contains 2 protons, 2 neutrons and 2 electrons. If you remove 2 electrons from the helium atom, then it contains only 2 protons and 2 neutrons in the nucleus. That helium nucleus we are calling as nothing but alpha particle. So alpha particle is nothing but a helium nucleus or singly ionized helium atom. You can write singly ionized helium atom or helium nucleus. So nothing but He+ also we can write singly ionized helium atom. That's only called as alpha particle. But here what is the charge of the alpha particle means it is a positively charged. Correct? Because electrons already removed, that's why it is a positive charged. So alpha particle is having a positive charge. what is the charge of this alpha particle? We can write q is equal to, so 2He4 means with atomic number 2, mass number 4. So generally charge how to find? It contains 2 protons, 2 neutrons. But neutrons are completely neutral. There will be no charge. Only protons are having a charge. So charge of 1 proton is equal to, we can write a plus E. But charge of 2 protons equal to what? 2E you should write. That is equal to plus 2E. 2 times the charge of the proton. So, or we can write this value, it is equal to 2 into plus 2 into charge of 1 proton is equal to 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb, which is equal to plus 3.2 into 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. That is the charge of alpha particle. That is always having a positive charge. What is the mass of this alpha particle? So we can write mass of alpha particle. M alpha is equal to, it contains total 4 nucleons. Mass of one nucleon is equal, I'm writing M, where M is equal to mass of a proton. But mass of 4 nucleons equal to how much means? 4M. That equal to 4 times the mass of a proton. So then we can write here value, 4 times the mass of a proton or nucleon you should write. 4 into 1.67 into 10 to the power of minus 27 kg. It is a mass of the proton. So if you multiply, you'll get the value 6.64 into 10 to the power of minus 27 kg. It is a mass of alpha particle. It is having a charge and also having mass. So similarly, what is a specific charge? It is also having something a specific charge. What is a specific charge means, you should write S is equal to, or S alpha is equal to Q by M. Charge of the alpha particle by mass of the alpha particle. But already we know charge is equal to 2E by mass is equal to 4M. So you should write here that equal 2E by 2, 1s are 2s are cancelled, E by 2M you should write. Here E by M is equal to nothing but charge of the proton, specific charge of the proton. It is equal to half of the specific charge of the proton. So half of the specific charge of proton, which is equal to 1 by 2 into specific charge of proton should write. Half into this value should write. Generally specific charge of the proton is equal to 9.6 into 10 to the power of 7. What do you call 9.6 into 10 to the power of 7? If you take a half of this value, we'll get nearly 4.8 into 10 to the power of 7. So approximately you can write a 4.8 into 10 to the power of 7 coulomb per kg. It is a specific charge of alpha particle. So generally alpha particle can travel with a speed equal to 1 by 10th approximately. Speed of the alpha particle is equal to 1 by 10th of the speed of light. So we know speed of light is equal to 3 into 10 power 8. But it is having 1 by 10th of approximately 1 by 10th of the speed of the light. Or we can write nearly 0.05 times that of the speed of the light. So 3 into 10 power 8 by 10. So that is equal to 3 into 10 power 8 by 10 means 3 into 10 power 7 meter per second. It is the speed of the alpha particle, where C is equal to 3 into 10 to the power of 8 meter per second. That is the speed of the alpha particle. So same way, what is the ionization and the penetration power of the alpha particles, and also how it will be deflected in the electric and magnetic field. Whenever alpha particle is moving through an electric field, so some force will be acting on the alpha particle. What is the force means? F is equal to EQ, one formula is there, where E is equal to strength of the electric field, Q is equal to charge. So something force acting on the alpha particle because of the electric field, so it will be deflected. When it is moving through a magnetic field, F is equal to formula BQV sin theta, or BQV is there. Also, charge is there, strength of the magnetic field is there, speed is there. Also, it will be deflected by the magnetic field. So, alpha particle was deflected by both electric field and also magnetic field. So, it deflected by electric field and magnetic field. Both the fields can deflect the alpha particle. electric field and also magnetic field both can deflect the alpha particle. That you can write. So similarly, so alpha particle generally having a more ionization power. So because of the more charge, it has a more ionization power. So whenever alpha particle is passed through a gas, it can ionize the gas. So that's why it is having, it has a more ionization power. So because of the more charge comparing to beta and gamma, it has a more ionization power comparing to beta and gamma. But it is having a less penetrating power. Why it is having less penetrating power? Because of the more mass, 4 times the mass of the proton. That's why comparing to beta and gamma, it has a less penetrating power. Even for example, 0.1 thickness paper if you take, or maybe aluminum foil, it can absorb the alpha particle. So in the path of the alpha particle, if you place it one paper, sheet of paper, so hardly it can pass through the paper. Very difficult it can pass through the paper. That's why even 0.1 centimeter aluminum foil can also stop the alpha particle. That's why it is having a less penetrating power. Alpha particle has a less penetrating power. It has a less penetrating power. So that is 0.1 centimeter thickness. 0.1 centimeter thickness aluminium foil can absorb alpha particle. It is also able to absorb it. That's why very difficultly, hardly it can pass through a paper or 0.1 centimeter thickness aluminium foil. So it has a low penetrating power comparing to beta and gamma, but a high ionization power comparing to beta and gamma. So how many times it is having a more ionization power means comparing to beta, 100 times more. So sometimes the theory questions may be asked, compare the ionization power of the alpha, beta, gamma. Last I'll give the ratio. So here it is having a 100 times more ionization power comparing to beta particle, but 10,000 times more ionization power comparing to gamma ray. That's ionization power. Whereas the penetrating power, if you compare, it is having a very less penetrating power comparing to gamma rays, 10,000 times less penetrating power alpha particles. But comparing to beta rays, 100 times less penetrating power. That is this one. So similarly, whenever an alpha particle falls on a photographic plate, so generally in some of the experiments like J.J. Thomson experiment for finding a specific charge, we are using a photographic plate. Whenever the charged particle is incident on the photographic plate, what will be happen? They will produce some blackened dots. And if you develop in the lab, we came to know what type of particles those particles are. So here also, alpha particles are able to produce the photographic effect or photographic effect. So they can affect photographic plates. They can affect photographic plate. Photographic plate can be affected by alpha particles. Similarly, whenever alpha particle falls on, alpha particles falls on zinc sulfide. So zinc sulfide means what type of screen? Fluorescent screen. Or this type of, whenever it falls on the fluorescent screen, so some of the scintillations or bright spots can be observed. So that means alpha particle can produce or cause fluorescence. Sir, fluorescence means whenever some charged particles or particles falls on the zinc sulfide screen, some of the scintillations or bright spots can be observed. So that type of method we are calling, generally calling as fluorescence. So they cause fluorescence. Alpha particles can cause fluorescence. So they can affect the photographic plate and also they can cause fluorescence both. For example, when alpha particles falls on the human skin, what will be happen? So they are having some thickness. That's why alpha particle cannot penetrate and will not come outside through the human skin. So they will, whenever they fall on the human skin, so what will be happen? They will produce some of the rashes and so the burning effect can be produced by alpha particles. So these are some of the properties of alpha rays. Once again, alpha particles are nothing but helium nucleus. which is a single ionized helium atom. It is having a positive charge. So alpha particles are having a charge equal to 2 times the charge of the proton, that is a 3.2 into 10 power minus 19 coulomb. It is having a mass of 4 times the mass of the proton, that is 6.64 into 10 power minus 27 kg. Similarly, the specific charge of alpha particle is equal to half of the specific charge of the proton. So it is nearly 4.8 into 10 power 7 coulomb per kg. And alpha particle travel generally less than the speed of the light. It is nearly 0.05 times to 0.1 times that of the speed of the light, or roughly we can take 1 by 10th of the speed of the light, where c is equal to 3 into 10 power 8 meter per second in air or vacuum. Similarly, whenever alpha particle is moving through an electric field, some electrostatic force acting on the particle and the alpha particle will be deflected. Whenever it is moving through some magnetic field, so magnetic force acting on the alpha particle also deflected. So in both the fields, alpha particle deflected. And here generally, in case of the electric or magnetic field, alpha particle deflects less. Comparing to beta, they will deflect less. So with such a less deflection only, we can identify these are alpha particles. With a more deflection, we can identify they are beta rays. Without deflection, we can identify they are gamma rays. Correct. That is it. Similarly, because of the more charge comparing to beta and gamma, they are having a more ionization power. They are having a 100 times more power comparing to beta rays, 10,000 times more ionization power comparing to gamma rays. Similarly, because of more mass, they are having a less penetrating power. So comparing to beta, they are having a 100 times less. Comparing to gamma, they are having a 10,000 times less penetrating power. Even thick paper, even a paper also able to stop the alpha particle. If take a 0.1 centimeter aluminum sheet or aluminum foil, so it can stop the alpha particle, it can absorb the alpha particle. So alpha particle having a less absorption power. Whenever alpha particle falls on a photographic plate, some of the black dots will be produced. If you develop in the lab, we can identify the nature of the alpha particles or nature of the particles also. So they can produce effect photographic plate. Whenever alpha particles falls on the zinc sulfide screen, one screen we have to coat with the zinc sulfide, then what will be happened? So whenever alpha particles falls on this zinc sulfide screen, we can observe some scintillations, bright spots. So that's why it can produce or cause fluorescence. And whenever alpha particle falls on the human skin, they can cause a burning effect. And they can sometimes damage a little bit of living tissues also. So that these are nothing but the properties of alpha particles or alpha rays, you should write. Generally, approximate distance of the alpha particle range. How much means, for example, from the source, if you release the alpha particle with a high energy, it will come outside. And after traveling nearly 2.7 centimeter to 8.6 centimeter, depending upon the source, and intensity of the source. So nearly after traveling 2.7 centimeter to 8.6 centimeter, they can lose their energy. And up to that distance only, they are able to travel. They are having a range will be less. That is called range of the alpha particle. They are nothing but properties of alpha rays. So all these are for complete exams. So one more questions important. Complete exams, the theory questions important. Now we'll go for second type of radioactive radiations, beta rays. Whenever alpha particles incident on the metals, what will be happening? They will be scattered. Like the same alpha particles we are using in Rutherford's alpha particle experiment, gold foil experiment. So when alpha particle falls on, alpha particle strikes a gold nucleus. Instead of moving along the straight path, the alpha particle get scattered. So they will be scattered by the metal plates, metals or metal targets. Second one, beta rays. What are beta rays and what are the basic properties of beta rays? Second one, beta rays. So beta rays are nothing but what generally? Fast moving electrons. So beta rays are nothing but fast moving electrons. These are fast moving electrons. But here one important thing you have to understand. So these are electrons which are having a same mass, same charge that as that of an electron which is revolving around the nucleus. But beta rays are not the electrons which are emitted from the outer from the orbits of the electrons. So beta rays are only electrons which are released from the nucleus. But there may be one question arises. But nucleus does contains only protons and neutrons. But how beta particles are emitted from the nucleus? Only at the time of the disintegration or decay process or radioactivity process. So these beta particles are released from the nucleus. That's important. So these are the fast moving electrons emitted from the nucleus. Fast moving electrons emitted from nucleus, emitted from nucleus during disintegration or decay process, during the disintegration or decay process. But what is the charge of this electron? Sometimes it is also important theory question. So beta particles are nothing but electrons in the outermost orbit of an atom, electrons in the innermost orbit of an atom, or electrons released from the outermost orbit of an atom, electrons released from the innermost orbit of an atom, and free electrons released from the atom, and electrons released from the nucleus at the time of the decay process or disintegration process. So option 4 correct. So beta particles are nothing but fast moving electrons which are emitted from the nucleus at the time of disintegration or decay process. But what is the charge of the beta particles? They are having a negative charge. So charge of the beta particle is equal to nothing but a minus E. Generally beta particle, they mentioned means we have to understand it is a beta minus particle. That is nothing but minus. If particularly they mentioned for example beta plus, then we have to go for a positively charged particles. Exactly antiparticle of electron, which is also called a positron, we can take. So until and unless they mentioned beta plus, we have to understand it is a beta minus only. So that is having a charge is equal to minus 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. That is a charge of a beta particle. And a charge, it is a beta minus. If it is a charge of a beta plus particle, we should write a plus 1 point plus E. That is called a plus 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb, we should write. Charge of the beta minus, beta plus. And one more, what is the mass of this beta particle? Mass m beta is equal to nothing but equal to mass of the electron. Mass of the electron we know 9.11 into 10 to the power of minus 31 kg. That is the mass of a beta particle equal to electron, nothing but. If you divide both, what will get? Specific charge. Beta particle also having something a specific charge. What is the specific charge? Means S is equal to Q by M or E by M, which is equal to 1.76 into 10 to the power of 11 coulomb per kg. It is a more specific charge comparing to the proton or maybe alpha particle or deuteron, triton, such type of particles. It is a more specific charge, 10 to the power of 11 coulomb per kg. And what is the speed of the beta particle? Generally beta particles also travel with a speed less than the speed of the light, not exactly equal to speed of light, less than the speed of the light. How much means it is equal to v is equal to 0.9 times that of the speed of the light, 0.09 c should write. So approximately 99% of the speed of the light you can write. Approximately it is 0.09 times the speed of the light to 0.9 times the speed of the light. So not exactly, nearly equal to speed of the light, but less than speed of the light. And it is also affected by both electric field and also magnetic field. So it is deflected by, beta particle also deflected by electric field, because it is having something a charge, and also magnetic field deflected by electric and magnetic fields. Whenever beta particle moving through an electric field or magnetic field, force is acting and also it will be deflected. But here there will be more deflection comparing to alpha particle. That's why by using this deflection only we can identify whether it is a beta or alpha particle. That is. And one more, it has less ionization power. So ionization power how many times less? 100 times less comparing to alpha particle. So generally you can write it is ionization power is 1/100th of alpha particles or alpha rays. 1/100th of an alpha particle. So check here, comparing to beta it is a more, but comparing to alpha it is a less. That's why the ionization power of a beta particle is a 1/100th of ionization power of the alpha particle. But what about penetrating power? Because of the less mass, it has a more penetrating power comparing to gamma alpha, but less comparing to gamma. You should write it has penetrating power is 100 times that of an alpha particle, that of an alpha particle. Comparing to alpha particle, penetrating power is 100 times more. Means even it is able to pass through a 5 centimeter thick aluminum foil also. But whereas alpha particle, 0.1 centimeter thickness aluminum foil can also stop the alpha particle. Hardly it can pass through a paper. Whereas through 5 centimeter thick aluminum foil also the beta particle can pass. So they are having 100 times more. And one more, it is also causes a photographic effect and also fluorescence. Because a charged particle means whenever it falls on the photographic plate, we can observe some of the black dots and a photographic effect. Whenever it falls on the zinc sulfide screen, we can observe some of the scintillations or bright spots. So it produces both photographic effect and also fluorescence. So it produces or it can affect photographic plate. It can affect a photographic plate and also it causes fluorescence. It causes fluorescence both. It causes a fluorescence and also affect a photographic plate. But whenever a beta particle incident on the human body, it can penetrate through the human body and sometimes it may damage some of the little bit of tissue also. And also causes some burning effect also the beta particle. But the range of the beta particle is more than that of alpha particle. So nearly it can travel a few centimeters, like around 15 to 20 centimeter also it can travel. Nearly 30 centimeter also it can travel. But whereas alpha particle only 2.7 centimeter to approximately 8 centimeter. So it is having a more range comparing to alpha particle. So that is about beta particles and the properties of beta rays. Generally inside the nucleus, whenever a proton is converted into neutron, for example, I'm taking a proton is converted into neutron. So we have to balance the equation. Proton means you write atomic number 1, hydrogen nothing but I'm taking, and here also 1. But neutron it is equal to 0, N1 I'm writing. So if you subtract 1 minus 1 is equal, here we'll get 0. Here 1 minus 0 is equal to 1. It is nothing but positron. Inside the nucleus, a proton is not a permanently proton. Neutron is also not a permanently neutron. So proton may be converted into neutron and a neutron also converted into proton because of the absorption of the mesons. Here also, whenever a proton converted into neutron, we got one particle called beta plus, which is equal to positron. But always a positron is accompanied by one particle called a neutrino. Symbol nu you should write. So it is equal to positron, it is a neutrino will be emitted. So this will be positron or beta plus particle. And this will be neutrino. Same way, whenever a neutron is converted into a proton, check what will get. So your plus you should write, minus 1 e 0 plus one more particle anti neutrino. For every particle there is an anti particle, like electron, positron, proton, anti proton, neutron, anti neutron, neutrino, anti neutrino. Here also, during the conversion of the neutron to proton inside the nucleus, we got one electron. So this will be called as a beta minus particle or electron. And here this will be called as anti-neutrino. Anti-neutrino. So these are nothing but the properties of the, this may be asked question, competitive exams. So during the conversion of the proton to neutron, along with the positron, the particle emitted is neutrino. So during the conversion of the neutron to proton, along with electron, the particle emitted is anti-neutrino. So based on the question, we have to answer. So it is about the beta rays. It's a fan of this. Last. Last. Fine. So third particles we can call gamma rays. Alpha, beta, and the third one is right, gamma. Gamma rays. But here, what are gamma rays? We have electromagnetic radiations and also electromagnetic spectrum also there, like a gamma rays, ultraviolet rays, gamma rays, x-rays, ultraviolet rays, visible light, and also infrared rays, microwaves, and radio waves. So gamma rays also similar to remaining all the rays like x-rays, ultraviolet, visible light, like which belongs to the electromagnetic spectrum. So these are nothing but electromagnetic radiations, similar to electromagnetic radiations, similar to electromagnetic radiations like X-rays, comma UV rays, etc. So these also like electromagnetic radiations only, but they emitted from the nucleus at the time of the disintegration or decay process. But generally they are having a wavelength. In electromagnetic spectrum, the rays which are having a least wavelength means gamma rays only. Highest wavelength, radio waves. But these are having a least wavelength or most frequency, highest frequency. They are having a wavelength range from 0.01 angstrom unit to, they are having a 0.1 angstrom unit. They are having a value like this. 0.1 angstrom means 10 power minus 10. So 0.01 into 10 power minus 10 means nearly 10 to the power of minus 12 meter to, it is equal to 10 power minus 11 meter. 10 power minus 12 to 10 power minus 11. If you want to make convert into nanometer or maybe centimeter or meter like that. And if you want to calculate the frequency, so we have one formula, nu is equal to c by lambda, where c is equal to speed of light, 3 into 10 power 8. Divided by lambda value here given, we can find the range also. So these are the rays which are a part of electromagnetic spectrum, similar to X-rays, ultraviolet rays, gamma ray, like radio waves, microwaves, like that. And these particles are having no charge, completely zero charge. So they are neutral. Charge of gamma rays, Q is equal to zero. They are having no charge, and their rest mass also zero. Whenever a gamma ray is at rest, it will not exist. So rest mass of the gamma rays is also equal to zero. They are having no charge and also no rest mass. But whenever no charge and no rest mass, no specific charge also. Specific charge, yes, gamma also equal to zero. There will be no specific charge. And but they can travel with a speed equal to the speed of the light. So speed of the gamma rays equal to c, that is equal to 3 into 10 to the power of 8 meter per second in air or vacuum. So they can travel with this much speed. But here, as they are not having any charge, whenever they are passing through electric or magnetic field, what will be happened? We know when they are passing through electric field, F is equal to formula EQ. As they are having no charge, zero, that is called a force acting on the gamma ray is equal to zero. Whenever no force acting on the gamma ray, there will be no deflection. So same way, when they are moving through a magnetic field, formula F is equal to BQV, perpendicular to the magnetic field. Here also, strength of the magnetic field B, but charge is equal to zero and the speed is equal to V, also zero. So no force acting on the gamma ray when it is moving through electric field or magnetic field. That's why they are not deflected. They can move along the straight path. That's important. So they are not deflected by, they are not deflected, gamma rays were not deflected by electric field and magnetic field, not deflected by electric field and also not deflected by magnetic field. There will be no deflection, but because of the less charge, they are having a zero charge, means there will be almost a negligible ionization power. So ionization power is 1/10,000th of an alpha particle. Comparing to alpha particle, it is a 10,000 times less. Correct. Means ionization power of alpha particle, gamma ray, is a 1/10,000 times comparing to like alpha particle, you should write. But what about penetrating power? Because of the rest mass equal to zero or negligible mass, it is able to travel, penetrate highly. Even a 30 centimeter thick iron block, if you place, it is able to come outside. Even through the human body also, it will come outside, having a large penetrating power. Because of the large penetrating power, it may cause or it may damage some of the living tissue or delicate tissue also. They are more harmful comparing to alpha particles. So they are having a more penetrating power. Penetrating power is 10,000 times more comparing to alpha. So penetrating power. Is 10,000 times, not 1,000, 10,000 times that of an alpha particle. Comparing to alpha, 10,000 times more, but comparing to beta, 100 times more. Here comparing to alpha, 1/10,000th, but comparing to beta, 1/100th, you should write. So similarly, it also can produce a photographic effect. It affects a photographic plate. So all the three rays can affect the photographic plate. And all the three rays can produce fluorescence also. It causes fluorescence. But range also more. Because of the more penetrating power, it is able to travel a more distance without a loss of energy also. So range also more. Penetrating power is more, but ionization power is less. It can cause photographic effect. And also, whenever it falls on some of the metals, like alkali metals, what will be happened? Or some of the metals, it can produce a photographic, photoelectric effect also. But remaining alpha, beta cannot produce a photoelectric effect. So, it can produce photoelectric effect. Photoelectric effect means whenever gamma rays are falls on some of the metals, So the electrons are emitted from the metal plate, and which causes some photo current also, and that is called a photoelectric effect. So generally gamma rays are produced from the nucleus at the time any excited nucleus come to the normal state. Generally while emitting alpha or beta particle, a nucleus may get excited. After some time there is a process of the de-excitation. At the time of the de-excitation, gamma ray will be produced. So that's important. So because of the gamma ray, there will be no change of the charge number, no change of the mass number. So these are all the properties of the alpha, beta and gamma rays. While studying also, better to compare alpha, beta and gamma. So I have given individually nearly 10 points around, nearly 10 points like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, nearly approximately 10 points you can choose. If you design a simpler tabular column, or already I have sent material, both PUC as well as NEET also through WhatsApp, and better to go through the material. Already we have given one box type only, or else try to you only put one box and write alpha particle, beta particle and gamma particle. Each and every property try to compare. What is the identity? What is the mass? What is the charge? What is the specific charge? What is the speed? How they will affected by electric and magnetic fields? What is their ionization power, penetrating power? What is their speed? And also how they will produce the photoelectric photographic plate? How they can cause the fluorescence? What is the range? Like this, we can write approximately 10 points for each and every particle. So total 3 means 3 tens are 30. So nearly indirectly we are preparing 30 theory questions for complete exams, correct? So sometimes the ratio may be asked. What is the ratio of ionization power of the alpha, beta, gamma? I'll write here. Ionization power of alpha particle is 2. Ionization power of the beta particle is 2. Ionization power of gamma. Generally alpha particle we are saying more ionization power. It is equal to 10,000 times. 10,000 times is to 100 is to 1. From this easily we can understand which particle has more ionization power and which particle has less ionization power. Same way, what is the penetrating power? Here I am writing a P, alpha, penetrating power of beta, penetrating power of gamma. So alpha one time means, whereas beta is equal to 100 times, and gamma is equal to 10,000 times. Should write like this. So the ratio important for complete exams. Penetrating power of the alpha, beta and gamma rays. So it is about alpha, beta and gamma rays, which are also called radioactive radiations. Next, radioactivity concept also studied by the scientist Rutherford and also Sardi and also Rutherford, and after studying they also given two three laws, group displacement laws. What happens when a radioactive sample emits one alpha particle or beta particle or gamma particle? What will be happened? Gamma ray. Correct. Rutherford and Sardis. Displacement loss or group displacement loss. Rutherford, Sardis, group displacement loss or simply displacement loss. Generally radioactivity is nothing but a nuclear phenomenon. So not affected by external parameters like temperature, pressure or maybe physical properties, chemical properties or also stress or strain, the type of all the properties not affected the radioactivity concept. One more, radioactivity is a purely a chance, matter of the chance. So which atom first disintegrated, which atom next disintegrated, we cannot say. That is a purely the depends upon the probability and our matter of the chance only. Next, in a radioactive sample, one atom cannot emit both alpha particle and beta particle simultaneously. For example, I am choosing one uranium atom. In a uranium sample, I am selecting one atom, uranium atom. It emits either alpha particle or beta particle, but not at the same time. It at a time, it cannot emit alpha, it cannot emit beta. So after emitting alpha or beta particle, what will be happen? The uranium nucleus get excited. At the time of the de-excitation, it can emit one gamma ray, gamma photon. That is nothing but in a radioactive sample, different atoms may emit alpha beta particles. For example, I am choosing a uranium sample. In this uranium sample, it is a one atom. It is second atom. This first atom can emit alpha particle. At the same time, it cannot emit beta particle. It emits either alpha or beta. But the second atom may emit beta particle. That's important. So the first atom can emit either alpha or beta, but not at the same time. Second atom can emit either beta or alpha, but not at the same time. But at a time, two different atoms may emit alpha and beta also. After emitting alpha or beta, what will be happen? The nucleus get excited. At the time of the de-excitation, it can emit one gamma photon. Every time, if a radioactive sample emits 10 alpha particles, so we can expect 10 gamma photons. If a radioactive sample emits 5 beta particles, we can expect 5 gamma photons. If a radioactive sample emits 10 alpha, 20 beta, then 10 alpha, 20 beta. So total number of how many gamma photons we can expect? 30 gamma photons. 10 alpha means 10 gamma, 20 beta means 20 gamma. So total 30 gamma photons. That's important. Now, what Rutherford and Soddy is saying means, according to Rutherford and Soddy's group displacement laws, a radioactive sample can emit either alpha or beta particles. A radioactive sample can emit alpha or beta particle, but not simultaneously. But not at the same time. It can emit either alpha particle or beta particle, but not at the same time. That's important. And after emitting alpha or beta particle, the nucleus gets excited. The nucleus gets excited. During a de-excitation, it can emit gamma photon. During de-excitation of a nucleus, not atom, during a de-excitation, it emits a gamma photon or gamma ray. For example, if it emits alpha particle, what will be happened? When a radioactive sample emits one alpha particle, what may be happened? When a radioactive sample, I am choosing one sample as X with atomic number Z and a mass number A. So atomic number of this element is equal X and the mass number is equal A. Whenever this sample emits one alpha particle, so alpha means what? Helium nucleus. So we can write the symbol as He2 and 4, you should write mass number 4, atomic number 2. So original element is equal atomic number Z, but already here 2 came outside. But what is the remaining here? Z minus 2 you should write, because atomic number reduces by 2. Here mass number is equal A, but already here 4 written. Remaining what you should write? A minus 4. Whenever atomic number changes, the name of the element also changes. So here I am writing a Y. Check here. What happens when a radioactive sample emits one alpha particle? Its atomic number decreases by 2 and the mass number decreases by 4. In the periodic table, what is the position of this element? For example, if you take a periodic table, it is a original element. But after emitting alpha particle, the new element may not be at the same place. It falls two columns to the left side of the original element. So here, whatever the original element is there can be called as a parent element or parent nucleus. This can be called as a parent nucleus or parent element. This can be called as a daughter nucleus or daughter element. Or it is a parent nucleus or parent element or parent nucleus. This can be called daughter element or daughter nucleus. And this can be called alpha particle. Alpha particle. So we can write one example. Uranium with atomic number 92, mass number 238. It emits one alpha particle. What will get, how will get the new element? Here it is equal to helium, 2He4, you should write same. Here 92 minus 2 equal 90. 238 minus 4 is equal to 234. Then this new element is called as a thorium. Example correct. So first one about alpha decay process. What will be happened? When a radioactive sample emits one alpha particle, its atomic number decreases by 2 and the mass number decreases by 4 and the new element, which is also called daughter element, the new element falls two columns to the left side of the parent element. So what does it mean? Like it is a, for example, in the periodic table, I am selecting like this. Like it is, for example, 90, it is equal 91, 92, 93, 94. First, I have chosen the uranium, which is called parent element. This one parent element. Then after emitting alpha particle, what will be happening? We got one daughter element as 90, thorium. So it falls one and two columns to the left side of the parent element. That is the meaning. So after emitting alpha particle, the what is the position of the new element means two columns to the left side of the parent element. That is about alpha particle emission. Next, second one about beta particle. What happens? Beta particle means when I am choosing XZA emits one beta minus. Beta minus means nothing but electron. So I'll write symbol here. It is equal electron minus one E zero. Now we have to balance. Here zero means no change of the mass number. Same you should write A. But what about atomic number here? Minus one written means I'll write here plus one, Z plus one. Now add both Z plus one, minus one. Minus one plus one cancelled, we'll get same only. And here along with electron, one more particle called as antineutrino will be emitted. Now it is called parent nucleus. Parent element or parent nucleus. And this can be called as a daughter nucleus. Daughter nucleus. And it is a beta minus particle. This is a beta minus and antineutrino. So now check what happened. When a radioactive sample emits one beta minus particle, its atomic number increases by one, but the mass number remains the same, no change. And the new element falls one column to the right side of the parent element, because here we have written plus. It falls one column to the right side of the parent element. And here along with the beta minus particle, one more particle emitted called as antineutrino. That's important. If you take one example, like a thorium, atomic number 90, mass number 234, it emits one beta minus particle. So here 234 remains the same, no change. But 90 becomes 91, which is called a protoactinium, PA. Protoactinium, because atomic number plus one you should take. So 90 plus one, 91. Here electron minus one is zero, plus one antineutrino will be emitted. So it is a parent element, it is a daughter element. Same way, when it emits one beta minus, for beta plus for example, what you should take? XZA emits one beta plus particle, it becomes YZ minus 1 A. It is equal, you should write beta plus means E plus 1 0 plus 1 neutrino, you should write. Exactly opposite process, when a radioactive sample emits one beta plus particle, its atomic number decreases by 1, but mass number remains same. The new element falls one column to the left side of the parent element. For example, if you write phosphorus and sulfur, phosphorus with atomic number 15, and mass number is equal atomic number 16 and mass number is equal to 32 and sulfur with mass number 32 atomic number 15 when it is converted then what will be happen atomic number increases by 1 but mass number remains same you should write that is about beta decay process but what about third one gamma xza it is equal to gamma also it is equal to xza so that is nothing but you should write gamma photon check here any difference is there because gamma has no atomic number no mass number so when a radioactive sample emits one gamma photon its atomic number and mass number no change but how gamma photon will be emitted after emitting alpha particle or beta particle the nucleus get excited at the time of the de-excitation only it emits one gamma photon in this one it is excited nucleus excited nucleus whereas this one a normal nucleus which come to the normal state you should write that will be last one gamma photon anyone may write example but no change of the atomic number no change of the mass number you should write so these are about Rutherford and Soddy's group displacement laws in next class we'll discuss about radioactive decay law and one derivation is there for 5 marks I'll discuss that so okay thank you